stories, in a way, enable us to begin to make sense of things. You need food to live, and you need water to exist. You need those basics. You need shelter. You need clothing or whatever. But I would put stories on the same level, on the same par.
Hi everyone, and welcome to our special program on the power of storytelling. You've just heard from award-winning writer and educator Arnold Zable. Arnold believes story is not just fundamental to our own lives, but also a powerful tool to change perceptions about older people. We'll hear more of Arnold's insights throughout the program. Today, we visit teams at UnitingCare Ageing's Starrett Lodge and Baptist Community Services' Maranoa Centre in New South Wales. Both are Better Practice Award winners. They've been capturing older people's stories in a variety of creative and accessible formats. They'll share examples of their work and talk us through some of the many different ways we can all engage with story, from a simple conversation to using posters, books, and movie making. So let's delve deeper into the world of storytelling and learn how it all started for residents and staff at Starrett Lodge. So here's their story.
Well, we were up one morning on a Saturday morning, and Vicky was there, and she said, just said, "What do you think about writing a book?" Well, we all thought it was a wonderful idea, and that's how it just all started.
Well, we started doing scrapbooking. We were getting all their old photos, and they each had little stories to tell with their photos, and they were telling each other, and they were really interesting, and I thought, why don't we record it in a book?
This is the book, the project, A Long, Long Look Back. A story of 13 people, their lives and their history, spoken with their own words from the time when they were young, when they first met their husbands, when they first went to school.
Got them together in a group, like we'd sit around having morning tea, and then I'd ask them questions, but they would get a bit starstruck, so I got a list of questions for each, like where were you born, who were you born to, and gave it to them the week before. If they could write, they wrote them out and brought them with them and read them out in front of the others. But if they couldn't write, I recorded it or hand wrote it as they said it.
There'll be one or two people in the group that can't shut up, but that is all part of it. And it is all exciting.
The great stories emerge out of conversation. And so in the process, both people become transformed. The person that's telling the story is being transformed by the fact that they're given an opportunity to go over something in their life, and they're saying, oh, someone's interested. Someone's actually interested in hearing this. And then the listener is transformed because they're finding out more about this person, that this person has led a life.
It was wonderful to look back. That's what the book was called, A Long, Long Look Back. And I can remember back to when I was 3, because I was born with polio. I had to wear lace-up boots till I was 11. That was traumatic because the boys all called me Puss in Boots and Hopalong Cassidy and all those strange names. And even after I was married, I'd go into town and walk down the street and you'd see someone in front walking towards you and their eyes would drop down to see why you were limping. And that always upset me. I had to stand still and look into a shop window and pull myself together for a few minutes, you know, before I could go on.
The act of writing a story, telling a story, even entering into a conversation, and sharing stories and experiences, these are forms of expression. As you begin to get it out, you begin to work it out.
Well, I think it's good for you to get all your feelings out and rather than hold them in, because that can do you a lot of damage.
Well, everyone wants to be heard, don't they? And they're being heard. People are hearing their story and they're being validated, like, yeah, you're worthwhile. Your life hasn't been in vain. You're not just come to the end to sit here and, you know, you've done great things. And I think confidence, like, their confidence has boosted.
Well, I had major surgery and I was quite unwell. And it took me about a year to really recover. And I had lost confidence in myself over the years. I felt as though there was nothing really for me to... I wouldn't say nothing to live for. I had my family. And when I came out to Starrett Lodge and became involved with different things, especially the book, it lifted me no end, you know. I was really proud of myself. Seemed to build my health up as well because I had something to be proud about. And, you know, I had a lot of confidence through it. It just changed me a lot.
We had a book launch and their family came and they were stars. They signed the books as they were being sold and...
We were sitting at a long table and people were milling around everywhere.
We all had our head down nearly all night just signing.
Felt like one of the top authors.
It was a wonderful experience for us to think we've achieved something we never thought we would.
I believe that writing books and other activities like that certainly has a big impact on care because it makes a difference to how the residents feel about themselves, that they're able to do something like this and there are more things that they can do other than just sit around.
The book writing group at Starrett Lodge is a great example of how you can use stories to interact with older people and get to know them better. It provides opportunities for conversation in a safe and respectful environment. It helps people to cope with life changes and find meaning. People are able to contemplate their lives, feel validated, and celebrate their achievements. It can engage the community through events like book launches. And of course, it has a profound impact on the care you provide. At Baptist Community Services Maranoa Centre, Alstonville, Interactive Life Stories captures the stories of older people and presents them in posters and video documentaries. It's helped staff and relatives learn more about residents' pasts while also creating new stories together. Let's hear from the team about how it started.
We had a lady come here looking for some short-term employment, and in that period she struck up a relationship with one of the residents in the dementia unit. And to be honest, she wouldn't shut up about how great this person was. And because she was doing a writing at university, I asked her to write a story about her views. And when she wrote the story, I just was blown away with how insightful it was into that person's character. And so then I cooked up the idea that we should make a project out of this. And so we thought of the idea of making posters.
As a new staff member here, I was feeling a little overwhelmed, thinking, I have to get to know all of these people. How can I do that? And so looking at their posters helped me a lot. It helped me learn about Con and Betty and Bob. And the more I learn about the person, it actually makes it a lot easier from the clinical perspective.
Originally, it was designed to write stories about the residents. Sharon thought to make them digital would be a lot easier. And so we thought of the idea of using the same process to make movies.
One of the stories that made a big impression on me, as I work here as a volunteer and the things that I do are musical, we had this gentleman who wanted to join in but didn't know our English songs because he was Italian. And when the story started, we found that he loved opera music. And we had all this wonderful story about his life on the farm and how his children grew up on the farm. When the family came together to see the video, to watch him, was just the most amazing thing, because as he saw himself, he just came to life.
Very often what brings people back to life is the fact that someone's willing to listen to their story and to encourage them to tell their story.
You may be talking about their pet one minute, but then you'll get the whole story of how they met their wife and their husband, and it just sort of pours out of them then. Just taking some time to listen and getting them to tell their story, we suddenly, you find them get much more animated.
It's just an achievement. One that I never thought of. I even thought about writing my own story until I started to use the computer, and of course Sharon said, well, we do this sort of thing. It's refreshing to be able to think of some of the things that happened and that you've done. I just feel that I've achieved something worthwhile, actually.
You can come in and see a person, and what do you see? Someone that's old, or someone that's ill, or someone that's this, that, or the other. And then you begin to find out who they really are, and everything changes. You see someone in a different light.
I have found without exception that every single resident I've worked with has warmed my heart or taught me something, or I find it a very humbling experience.
The care staff have expressed in so many ways the value that they've had out of the materials that are produced by the Interactive Life Stories project, and that it really enriches the experience they have of caring for those residents.
I remember one special story about a gentleman that was in the Rats of Tobruk. He was 98 years old, and he never ever talked about the war before Sharon started doing the lifestyle stories.
So much to me, because I lost a lot of friends that was in my unit in the 6 years that I was overseas, and it does mean a lot to me. It's just a tradition that you pass on until they have another war.
Hopefully there won't be another war.
Yes, let's hope not.
So when I first met Murray, I didn't really know a lot about him. We do a bit of paperwork, but it doesn't really give you a great detail of what they've been through. And looking at the DVDs, I learnt a lot about him.
He had documents and a special medal that had come from being one of the Rats of Tobruk, and he had never, in his whole life, he had never spoken about that. He had never revealed it to anyone, and he was happy. He actually wanted to, at that point in his life, he was finally ready to share that information.
Murray, could you explain to me how you feel now that at the end of the recording process?
Well, the more I think about it, Sharon, I feel it's not only made me feel so good, it's probably making a lot of other people
they feel the same thing, same way.
Yeah. So it's been a good experience to talk.
It has been, yeah. No, and I'm not regretting it. I'm just so happy about it.
And it's lovely that you can share it with your family.
Yeah.
I think it's extremely important to care, because what they've been through, you can associate sometimes the behaviours that they may have, or especially things like Anzac Day with Murray. Every Anzac Day he would be so emotional. We used to take him into the onto the bus and go through the march, and that made a big deal to Murray. Very, very emotional on Anzac Day.
Maury's story has clearly had a profound effect on staff at Maranoa and the care they provide. But Maury's story would have gone unheard if someone hadn't been willing to listen or show an interest in learning more about him. Just enabling someone to share their story will give you a deeper understanding of their personality, needs, and emotions, and change how they feel about themselves. As a staff member, you will come to understand that everyone is unique and has their own story.
With the life stories, and when they get to know the person, it actually changes their approach to the residents, and it becomes a more sort of laid back and not so ritualistic. And in a sense, it transfers the power from the staff back to the resident.
By listening, by spending time, you give someone a chance to let out some feelings that they've been sitting on for a long time. And you know, sometimes they're really positive feelings. They go back and they'll say, look, I haven't thought about it for ages, but I just want to tell you about the birth of my son. And I'll tell you this great story, and there'll be this huge smile on their face, and it's just having someone to share that with.
One thing I've noticed about story, and also story told by older people, there is a kind of longing for what has been lost.
It's hard when you move out of your house, especially I think for a woman.
It's different in here.
Yeah.
To widows at home.
When Millie started to get ill and started to have nasty falls and things, and it was difficult to carry on there. And so we came down here, and I think that's just 3 years now. Well, Millie's memory's not too good. That's a bit of a problem. Uh-huh.
I've changed a lot.
You know, since you came in.
By the time you're in older age, there's always something that you once had. The difference between living out your final years with a sense of integrity as opposed to a sense of despair often meant whether or not you were able to kind of encapsulate your experience, shape your experience, and give it meaning, so that when you looked back on your life, you saw that it had meaning.
Our friendship grew, and when we were teenagers, we were going out together and picnics and things. We've been married for over 60 years now, but it's been a nice journey with Millie. Millie's been a good companion and friend. She's a lovely mother to the children.
Has it just been a love affair? It has, but more so. We just seem to hit it off together.
In one mouth. Everything's all right.
Well, it was all right, Dave. It was wonderful.
Oh, that's nice.
Been married a long time.
Mm-hmm.
I still love you.
You have me crying in a minute.
Well, I won't say anymore.
I thought it was really nice. It reflected us. You know, some of the stories were wonderful stories and people's great achievements that they've done, you know, either in education or this or that. And Millie sort of felt, you know, what's my story worth? And I was glad for it to be told, because it was worth it.
the stories are presented in a launch, and sometimes it's a grand event, and sometimes it's a much more low-key event, depending upon the person.
We would have a group of people there, you know, the person's family, their friends, and our staff, of course, are there.
Well, the family was really excited, yeah. And they said to me, "Dad, that's a record now for the whole family down to know about who their mum and dad was." So they were quite excited about it. They had tearful phone calls from one daughter up in Queensland. She thought it was lovely, and you know, she was a bit upset in a good way.
And there's a coming together to focus on that particular individual, on that particular resident.
We'll have entertainers come in, and we'll have lots of different speeches about the person. I might tell a story about their life, give a brief overview.
Barry grew up in Ballina in the 1940s.
Often relatives will get up and say something more personal to add another perspective. And inevitably, there are a lot of tears and a lot of tears of happiness.
A lot of happiness came into their lives in the form of a very sparky little fox terrier. It's making you a bit emotional.
The great value for the staff is that when a person comes into residence, you don't know them. All you see is what they are at the moment. And sometimes that's very, very difficult, because they have so many problems and you don't really know them. You don't know what they like, you don't know anything about them. And I think that doing this kind of thing really gives an insight to the real person, not the shell that you see when they come in. And that must make a difference to the way you handle people and the way you relate to them.
Betty was the first person I learned about through her story when I started working here. And she changed from being Betty, the person who occupies a bed, to being Betty, the lady with the great granddaughters who loves dressing up, who loved op shopping, who was a beautiful bride. It's a unique, interesting way to learn about a person, as opposed to reading through a pile of notes. And that's how we get information, clinical information. And so to find out about the person, to read it or hear it in a story, just gives it a different impact.
Storytelling becomes so much more than a light entertainment or some kind of obligation to fit in with this idea of person-centred care. It actually is person-centred care in action.
A lot of people in any place like this would benefit, for that could be their aim in life, to write their own book over a certain period and see what each one thought.
It changes the concept of just coming in for care. You still come in for life. People can live to 10 to 15 years in aged care. That's a big part of your life. And you still have to live. And that's what we have to provide, the why.
Don't I, darling?
Mm-hmm. You sure do.
And I think he's wonderful.